Okay, today we're going to talk about 2.3 graphing polynomial functions. And the objective will be to graph a polynomial function and to determine an equation for a polynomial graph. Now, when we do our graphs by hand, we are really focusing today on the roots of the equation. Those are going to be the zeros of the graph, or where the graph crosses the x-axis. And then as you go your homework, I want you to practice then looking at a graph and coming up with the factored form of the equation. So that part you're going to kind of discover today. All right, so let's get to work here. Now, graph f of x equals 2x to the third minus 7x squared plus 4x plus 20. So this is a cubic polynomial. So it could have three zeros. In fact, it does have three zeros if we think about double roots as two roots and things like that on a calculator. Then adjust your viewing window so you can see the complete shape of the graph. Okay, so here's what can tend to happen, okay, on the calculator. Well, when I'm picturing a cubic polynomial in my head whose leading coefficient is positive, I am picturing a graph that begins in quadrant 3 and has two turns and then ends up here in quadrant 1. And I'm just focusing on the leading term, the 2x to the third. That tells me this graph should have a shape something like this. So then, if I get out my calculator and I put y equals and I put that cubic polynomial into my calculator and I hit zoom standard, I put it on a standard window, look at what I see. A standard window. Now this is a window that is x from negative 10 to positive 10, and my y is negative 10 to positive 10. And that's called my x interval and my y interval, creating my standard window. Now, look at the graph. I don't see this cubic shape that I was thinking of right there. That looks almost linear. So what's the problem? It's my window. So we need to expand the window. So we need to conjecture by what we can see right here. And it looks to me like, well, look at the shape right here. It looks to me like this graph would need to be doing something like this. Yeah, exactly. Now that's a very rough sketch right there, but it looks to me as if I expanded my y interval, I could probably see the whole graph. So then it just becomes nothing but trial and error. So you've got to go to the window button on your calculator and expand your window. Make your x interval, leave that negative 10 to 10, and on the y interval, go from negative 100 to 100. Try something like that. So the new window, and there it is. And here's my corner bounds right here. X is going from negative 10 to positive 10 still, but y is going from negative 100 to 100, and make sure you know how to do this on your calculator. And there's the graph, and that's the general cubic shape that we were expecting right there. So that works for us, okay? So again, when you graph a polynomial, make sure you expand the window so you can see the general shape of the graph. You should know what a linear function is going to look like, what a quadratic function is going to look like, what a cubic function is going to look like, and so on. Okay, now, that graph again. Okay, and again, here's the general shape right here. Go back, picture the graph one more time. That's a pretty good general shape we had in our mind right here. So we can just use this. So think about this statement, and this is leading to calculus right here. So as x increases, we are traveling to the right on this graph. So as x gets bigger and bigger and bigger, as x increases without bound, does it look like y is also increasing? And this is how we say that in calculus. As x increases, y tends towards, and what is y getting closer and closer to? The concept infinity. And you can say this, y tends towards infinity, or you can say y approaches infinity. They both mean the same thing. All right. Now, as x decreases, so we're traveling to the left, what is y tending towards now? Y is tending towards negative infinity. That's calculus right there. Okay, we'll do more of that later. Now, do the same analysis of f of x equals negative x to the third minus 5x squared minus 12. And again, I'm going to focus on the leading term. Now, this is a cubic trinomial right here whose leading coefficient is negative 1. And if the leading coefficient is negative, that's my a right there, picture what that's going to do to the graph. Remember the graph we had with 2x squared as the leading term, and it did this shape right here. What do you think a negative might do to your typical cubic shape? Well, everything becomes the opposite of what it was, and that's kind of going to cause a reflection in the y-axis. So it's just going to flip it. So when I see this negative x to the third as a leading term, here's what I am picturing right there. Now, if I graph this function as y sub 1 and I put this on a standard window from negative 10 to 10 and the y-interval negative 10 to 10, look at what I see once again. I don't see enough. So I'm picturing I need two turns, or at least this cubic to flatten out and then take off. So what's going on right here? It looks like once again I'm going to need to increase my y-interval. So instead of going from negative to 10, negative 10 to positive 10, excuse me, I'm probably going to have to do the negative 100 to positive 100. I can leave my x's alone. So same window as I used last time, and now look at the graph. There it is. That's exactly what we were expecting right there. Okay, so now the same calculus question comes up. As x increases, so just get on this graph and travel right, that means x is increasing because I'm going to the right. What is this graph doing? It looks to me like y is tending towards, that's right, negative infinity. And as x decreases, well, that means I'm traveling to the left. Y is approaching, and that's right, y is approaching infinity. All right, great. Okay. Describe the general shape of a cubic function. How does the sign of the leading coefficient affect the graph? And that is what we just talked about right there. Okay, so here is my general cubic polynomial. F of x equals ax to the third plus bx squared plus cx plus d. All right, now a cubic polynomial. Now, didn't we just think about quadratics or cubics? And didn't we talk about a cubic has what? Two turns? So generally this looks something like that. That is what we were just thinking about right there. Okay, now also this cubic begins down here in quadrant 3 and then goes up and has one turn, two turns, and then finishes up here in quadrant 1. That tells me that this A has to be positive, as we saw in the cubic that had the leading term 2x to the third power. So a is greater than 0 if I am working from quadrant 3. And remember your quadrants, quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3, and quadrant 4. And this cubic is going from quadrant 1 or quadrant 3 to quadrant 1. And that tells us this a, the leading coefficient, has to be greater than 0. Now what if we flip it, like we saw in the second graph? Well, now I'm going from quadrant 2, one turn, two turns, and then I'm finishing in quadrant 4. That means my leading coefficient has to be less than 0. A is less than 0, like we saw on the graph with a negative 1x squared. So there's your general shapes. Make sure you have this in your notes. Okay. You can quickly sketch the graph of a cubic function by hand if the function is in factored form. And you're going to love this. And this is a quick sketch, but you are going to be amazed how accurate your graph actually is. Excuse me. Okay, so let's do one right now, real quick. So, f of x equals x plus 1 times x minus 1 times x minus 2. Now, this is a cubic because I have x times x times x, all right? And it is in factored form. Now, in factored form, I can see the roots immediately, and I hope you can too. So, there's my rough sketch of a graph right here, okay? Now, the roots. Do you see the factor x plus 1? Well, you know that the roots of a function occur when y equals 0. So if this f of x is 0, 0 equals x plus 1 times x minus 1 times x minus 2. So one of these three factors would have to equal 0. So what x's could make that happen? Well, look at the first one, x plus 1. If x were negative 1, wouldn't f of x be 0? So negative 1 is a root. So let's just go down here and put a dot at the negative 1. Now, what number minus 1 is 0? Well, that would be a 1. So that is also a root right there. And then what number minus 2 is 0? That would be 2. So 2 is a root right there. And now remember what we just talked about. X plus 1 times x minus 1 times x minus 2. If I expanded this, wouldn't my very first term be x to the third power? So my leading coefficient is 1. That's 1x to the third power. That tells me that a cubic whose leading coefficient is positive has to work from quadrant 3 and do a couple turns and then finish up here in quadrant 1. So there's my very rough sketch right there. And yeah, that is really rough. And right now, I'm not interested in the peaks and the valleys. Those do not have to be perfect. All right, that's the next lesson. And we're gonna use technology some to do that too. What I am interested in is that your roots are perfect. That this is clearly a root of negative 1 because of the factor x plus 1. That this is a root of positive 1 because of the factor x minus 1. And this is a root of positive 2 because of the factor x minus 2. Okay, the graph of f of x equals ax to the fourth plus bx to the third plus cx squared plus dx plus e. Oh my, that's a mouthful right there. But anyway, more simply, this is nothing more than a quartic because it is fourth degree polynomial. And I say polynomial because it has more than three terms. All right. So what does a quartic polynomial look like if you graph it? Know the general shape. Well, you know what a line looks like. You know what a quadratic looks like. And now you know that a cubic likely has two turns. Guess what? A quartic has likely three turns. So typically you get kind of a W type shape, okay? Especially if A, our leading coefficient, is greater than 0. A typical quartic looks just like this. All right, and now this quartic begins in quadrant 2, does a first turn, a second turn, and then a third turn, and it comes back and it finishes here in quadrant 1. All right, and that's going to be the case when your leading coefficient A is positive, when A is greater than 0. Now, what if A is less than 0? That's right, it's just going to reflect in the x-axis. So this W is going to flip to look more like now what, an M? Something like that right there. Yeah, that's a pretty rough M. That looks like my M when I was like in the second grade. Mike, yeah, it looks pretty good actually. And this one, this quartic now has been flipped, so it's going from quadrant 3 to quadrant 4. It still has three turns, but because it has been flipped in the x-axis, all right, I know A has to be less than 0. All right. So let's go to work. Notice I'm working with a little better graph to work with, a little better coordinate plane here. All right, so make sure you have some good graph paper to do this stuff. Okay, so now sketch the following graphs, and then we're going to use a calculator to check our graphs. Now, right now, we want to make sure that our roots are perfect, that is, our x-intercepts, all right, and peaks and valleys, right now, they're pretty rough, okay, and that's okay. That's okay. So take a look at this one. This is a cubic because it has three factors. And the leading coefficient, if I expanded this, would be 1 because my leading term would be 1x to the third. So that means odd degree is going to work diagonally. So I'm going to start down here in quadrant 3. And I'm going to go do one turn, two turns, and then finish up here in quadrant 1. Now, if I have my roots, I can do a very accurate graph. So look at this first factor of x. If I have a factor of x, well, if that x were 0, y would be 0. So my first root that I see right there is 0. There it is. Now look at the next factor, x plus 2. What's the root? Negative 2 plus 2 is 0, so the root, negative 2, right there. And now, the final factor is x minus 1, and 1 minus 1 is 0, so that means my third root, note, cubic and 3 roots, that's right, all right, there's my roots. And remember what I just said, this cubic, whose leading term would be 1x to the third power, has to work quadrant 3, to quadrant 1, and it's likely going to have 2 turns in the process. So I did a very rough sketch of this. Let me know how I did. And again, I think about that because of that x to the third right there. So here's what I'm saying. Let's make this official now. Okay? You start in quadrant 3. You go through your first root, in this case, negative 2, and then you take your first turn and work back through your next root, which is 0, and then make your second turn, and then work up through your third root, which in this case is 1, and then you finish here in quadrant 1, and as x increases, y is approaching infinity. That's it. Isn't that fun? And there's the calculator. So again, this is just a standard window right here where I can see the whole cubic shape there, and look at the accuracy. Not bad. This sketch by hand, pretty close. Not perfect by any means, you guys, but it is close. And that's all we need right now. All right. Let's take a look at B. Y equals, well, this is a 1, 2, 3. There are 4 factors, so this is a quartic whose leading coefficient would be positive. So I'm looking at 3 zeros right now. Look at the first factor, x plus 3. Okay, well, if x plus 3 is a factor, wouldn't negative 3 have to be a root? Right there. And then if x plus 1 is a factor, wouldn't negative 1 have to be a root? And if x minus 1 is a factor, then 1 would have to be a root. And if x minus 2 is a factor, then 2 would have to be a root. There's my 4 roots of my quartic right there. Now, quartic, that's 4th degree, all right? Even degree means I'm working on the graph horizontally, either quadrant 2 to quadrant 1 with 3 turns this time, or quadrant 3 to quadrant 4. And it's all about the leading coefficient, which is x to the 4th. You see the a of 1 right there? So A is greater than 0, and that implies I have to go quadrant 2 to quadrant 1. So I'm going to do a very rough sketch again right here and follow my arrow. This is what I'm visualizing. All right, I'm going to start in quadrant 2. I'm going to work through this single root. I'm going to take a turn. I'm going to work through that single root. And then I'm going to take a turn I'm going to work through this single root, and then I'm going to take one more turn and go through that single root and finish in quadrant one. Are you ready? There it is right there. Again, quadrant two, through the single root, first turn, that's my second root, that's my second turn, here's my third root, here's my third turn, and then through that last single root and finish in quadrant one. That's it. Become an expert. Ooh, now here's the calculator, and notice my valley right there, and this valley is below y equals negative 10, so that's a little bit off, all right? And you know what? This peak here is a little off. This is a lot more extreme. So if I had graphed this perfect, it would be a lot more deeper valleys and higher peaks there. All right, but again, right now, we are only focusing on the general shape and our roots. The general shape has to be really good. Do you guys see the W? I do. And the four roots are perfect. All right, now this one. First, it's a cubic. And if I expanded this, my leading term would be negative. Be thinking about that all the time. Now let's find the roots and then go to work. So if x is 0, this entire thing would be 0. First root, 0. And negative 2 plus 2 is 0, so my second root is negative 2. And then 1 minus 1 is 0, so my third root is 1. And I'm going to start using the term single roots to lead to double roots and triple roots. We'll get there. So those are all single roots. All right, we'll talk about why in just a second. Now, if I expanded this, do you guys agree that the leading term would be negative x to the third power? That tells me I'm cubic, so I'm working diagonally, but my leading coefficient a is negative 1, so rather than going from quadrant 3 to quadrant 1, we're reflecting and going from quadrant 2 to quadrant 4. So now watch my arrow. I'm visualizing starting in quadrant 2, going through my first single root, taking my first turn, and then going up through the origin, which is my second single root, and then taking my second turn, and then working down through my third and final single root, and finishing in quadrant 4. Let's see how we did. And there it is right there. It's rough, not perfect. This is just a sketch. Now let's look at the calculator. You know, not too bad. And when I was in college, there was no such thing as a graphing calculator. So this is how we had to do these graphs all the time. All right. And then we had to have ways using calculus to find our extrema. We're going to get that way down the road. Okay, let's do another one. Man, this is fun. Oh my. How many factors do we see here? 1, 2, 3. That's 5 factors. That means that is going to be a quintic polynomial with probably 5 zeros. All right, so let's do the zeros first, or the roots, and then we'll talk about what quadrant we're going to start at and things like that. So, negative x. Well, if x is 0, y is 0. My first single root, 0. What number plus 3 is 0? Negative 3. So that's my second single root, negative 3. Negative 1 plus 1 is 0. Negative 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. Positive 1. And 1 minus 2 is 0. That's going to give me a root of positive 2. All right. There's all my roots. This is going to be tough to sketch. If I did this again, I might make my hash marks on the horizontal axis 1/2 rather than 1 to spread my roots out a little bit. But you know what? We can make this work. Now you have to think. If you expanded this, I would have a leading term of negative x to the 5th power. So, that is a quintic polynomial whose leading coefficient is negative. That's odd degree, so we're working diagonal. But because the leading coefficient is negative, it is less than zero, that means rather than going quadrant 3 to quadrant 1, we're going to go quadrant 2 to quadrant 4. Now let's try to visualize this one. So, quadrant 2, we'll go down through the first single root and make our first turn, and then go through our second single root, and then make our next turn, and then go through our third single root and make our next turn, go through our fourth single root, make our next turn, and then go through our fifth single root and finish here in quadrant 4. So can you guys all picture that? All right, here it comes. Let's see how we did. Now, that's kind of pretty, isn't it? Note, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 roots. A typical quintic. And how many turns? 1, 2, 3, 4 turns. We began in quadrant 2 and we finished in quadrant 4. Those roots are perfect, so this would be a 5-point response on a test right there. Now, let's see how close we are from the calculator. And remember, the peaks and valleys may not be perfect. That's okay. Ooh, look at this first valley. Way down there. And then, you know, this peak is a little lower than that peak, and I kind of have them together there. So, that, you know, hey, this valley here is not too bad, huh? All right, there it is. This is my general shape right there. This is still a 5-point response right here. So next, let's quickly sketch y equals x plus 1 times x minus 1 times x minus k for a k equals 1.5, a k equals 1.3, and then a k equals 1.1. So what we're going to do is we're going to put 3 cubic graphs on the same coordinate plane so we can see what happens when this k gets closer and closer to 1, or this function is getting closer and closer to, instead of quantity x plus 1 times the quantity x minus 1 times the quantity x minus k. As k approaches 1, this goes to the quantity x plus 1 times the quantity x minus 1 squared. So that's going to create what I've talked about a little bit, a double root. So let's start with our first root. What number plus 1 is 0? Negative 1. There's my first root right there. And then what number minus 1 is 0? That's a positive 1. There's our second single root right there. And our first k is 1.5. So what number minus 1.5 is 0? Positive 1.5. And 2 is right there, so 1.5 would be approximately right there. And there's our third single root. Now, also, 3 factors, so this is cubic. If I expanded it, my leading coefficient would be positive. So I am going to work from down here in quadrant 3, go through the single root, take my first term, go through this single root, take my second term, and go through my third single root, and work up here, quadrant 1. There it is right there. Rough sketch, but it gets the job done. Now, next, k is 1.3. So this is a 1.3 right here. Now, the graph isn't going to change that much, except this root here for 1.5 would now become 1.3, or about right there. Now, let's do this cubic in green, and it's still gonna quadrant 3 through the first single root, make the first turn, go down through the second single root, and then it's gonna turn a little earlier and work back through that third single root and finish in quadrant 1. There it is right there. Pretty good, pretty good. Now, we're at k is 1.1. X minus 1.1 gives me a root of 1.1, which is going to go right there. Now I'm going to draw my third cubic, doing the same thing, except that third single root becomes the 1.1. So There it is right there. That one isn't quite as clean, but it gets the job done. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Do you guys see what's going on as my third root gets closer and closer to 1? It was here, 1.5, 1.3, and then 1.1. So, what happens as k tends towards 1? Well, as k gets closer and closer to 1, this root is getting closer and closer to the 1 right there. Okay, and that means my graph is going to have two roots right on top of each other. So that is one root right there, but we call that a double root. And here's what happens. Look at what the graph's going to do. It's going to start down here in quadrant 3. It's going to go through our first single root. And now I'm going to use that language. And then it's going to come up here and take our first turn. And then it's going to work down towards the double root. And you do not go through a double root. You come up and you flatten out and you just kiss the double root. And then you take off that way. So check it out. There it is in yellow right there. So what happens as k tends towards 1 or k approaches 1? Well, here you go. Two single roots become one double root. So these two single roots, the 1 and the 1.1, become one double root of x equals 1. So in general, what effect does a squared factor, as in y equals the quantity x plus 1 times the quantity x minus 1 squared, have on the graph of a polynomial function? Well, you're looking at that right there. You get a double root. So this cubic function would have one single root of x equals negative 1. Negative 1 plus 1 is 0. And one double root of x equals 1, because 1 minus 1 is 0. But that factor is being squared, creating a double root that counts for two roots. So our cubic still has three roots. A double root is always tangent to the x-axis. You guys know what that means? It means it comes down and it just kisses the x-axis. It does not go through it and then turns and goes the other way. All right, great little activity right there. Get these notes, understand these notes, know the difference between a single root, in this case negative 1, and a double root of, in this case, positive 1. Now it's time to have some fun. Effect of a squared or cubed factor. So now we're going to talk about double roots and triple roots. Double roots. P of x equals the quantity x minus c squared. So if I see these factors, I know that c is a root. And because this factor is being squared, I know that c has to be a double root. So this implies c is a double root of p of x equals 0. The graph of p then is tangent to the x-axis at x equals c. And if you know what that looks like, this is easy to graph. So let's go ahead and graph y equals the quantity x minus 1 times the quantity x minus 3 squared. And we'll do that. There's my coordinate plane. And I'm going to give you guys a little key here that deals with the color of the dot I'm going to use to signify the difference between a single root, a double root, and a triple root. So here it is. Now, you guys don't have to use colors and stuff like this, but you need to know when your root is single, double, or triple, and make sure your graph has the correct shape. So a single root, I'm going to use a red dot. For a double root, I'm going to use a blue dot. And then for a triple root, which we won't see in this graph right here, I'm going to use a yellow dot. So my first root is 1, and that's a single root. Red dot right there. My second root is 3, because 3 minus 3 is 0, and that is being squared, so that's a double root. That was at 3, 1, 2, 3. Let's put a blue dot right there. Now think to yourself, isn't this cubic? And wouldn't the leading term be 1x to the third power? So with that then, we have a cubic, which is odd degree, with leading coefficient positive, and that implies I'm going to go from what quadrant to what quadrant? Okay, and an odd degree polynomial is going to work diagonally. And if my leading coefficient is positive, I am going to go from quadrant 3, and I'm going to finish up here in quadrant 1. Now, let's picture it a second. Boy, my roots are over here, so it's hard to kind of show quadrant 3. So I'm probably going to start down here in quadrant 3 and work up through the single root, and then make my first turn, and then work down towards my double root. And this double root causes the graph to be tangent to the x-axis, and then finish back up here in quadrant 1. 3, 2, 1, there it is. Oh, beautiful. Notice we're not checking with a calculator. We're getting really confident. This is how we graphed back in the day before the graphing calculator, and it really helped us understand polynomials. And that's why we still do it today, even though you guys have graphing calculators. Next one. Well, what are we going to do here? All right. Ooh, y equals x minus 1 times the quantity x minus 3 squared times the quantity x minus 4. So the first root I see is a 1, and that would be a single root. Let's put a red dot at 1. And then the second root I see is 3. 3 minus 3 is 0, but that's being squared. That factor is being squared, so my 3 is a double root. So we're going to put a double root right here at the 3. And then finally, I have another root of 4, because 4 minus 4 is 0, and that's a single root. So let's put a single root at 4, put a red dot right there. Now, if I expanded this, I have x squared x, so that's fourth degree or quartic, and the leading coefficient would be positive. So here we go. Even degree, that's fourth degree if I expanded it, with leading coefficient positive, the leading coefficient would be 1 here. I have a 1x to the fourth, implies, now even degree, you work horizontally, and the leading coefficient is positive, we are going to go quadrant 2 to quadrant 1. 2 to 1. Alright, so let's picture the shape before I push the button. So I'm going to have to come up here slightly in quadrant 2 and work down through the first single root, take our first turn, and then work up to this double root. So I'm going to kiss the x-axis. Second turn, work down. Third turn, work back up, and finish in quadrant 1. There it is right there. Note the pretty rough W shape right there? That's your typical quartic. Okay, let's do one more of these. So now this time we're going to go y equals x squared times the quantity x minus 1 times the quantity x minus 3 squared. So I see two double roots and a single root. So my first double root would be at 0. Let's put a blue dot there. My single root would be a 1. Let's put a red dot right there. And my double root, my next double root would be a 3. So 2, 3, blue dot right there. So there are 3 zeros to this graph, but we're calling this 3 right here a double root. So that counts as 2. So that gives me my 4 roots right here. Alright, now, if I expanded this one, second degree, third degree, fifth degree, that's a quintic. So that's an odd degree polynomial, and the leading coefficient would be positive here. I see 1x to the fifth power. So, here we go. Odd degree with leading coefficient positive implies, okay, odd degree, we're working diagonal. Leading coefficient positive, we're going to go quadrant 3 to quadrant 1. So let's visualize. Down here in quadrant 3, we're coming up to a double root. So I've got to take my first turn right at the x-axis. And then work down, take my second turn, and then go through the single root, and then take another turn right here, and then work down through that. Now, let's see. Let me make sure. I don't know. That didn't sound right to me. Again, one more time. All right. We are going one more time, quadrant 3 to quadrant 1. So we have to start down here and go through the single root. Oh, I see. Hold it. This one's a double root. Take a turn. Take another turn. Go through the single root. And then take a turn. And then take another turn of the double root. There it is right there. All right. So let's see if that's what we have. All right. You see it again? Start in quadrant 3. There's the shape of a double root. A little rough there. Take a turn. Go through the single root. And then work back towards the double root. And there's the graph. That's not bad right there. All right. And that's a pretty complicated polynomial. Isn't it great to look at something this complicated and be able to come up with a graph that is this accurate? And I promise you, that's not bad. The peaks and valleys might be off just a little bit. But these tangents, that peak and that valley are perfect. Okay, so it looks like we're done talking about the double roots right now. And you see or cubed factor above? If I have a cube factor, that is going to create a triple root. And we're going to use a yellow dot for a triple root. And I'll show you how to draw a triple root in just a moment right here. So, write this down. P of x equals the quantity x minus c to the third power. So I know that c would have to be a root because c minus c is 0. And because this factor is being cubed, I know that that c would have to be a triple root. So that implies c is a triple root of p of x equals 0. And here's the shape. That implies p flattens out around the point c 0. That c is a root and crosses the x-axis at this point. And I'm going to show you that shape in just a moment. So here is our problem right here. We're going to graph y equals the quantity x minus 2 to the third power. Now this is a cubic. And remember early on when I told you, okay, the typical shape of a cubic is, you know, start down here in quadrant 3, make a turn, make another turn, and finish in quadrant 1. But this triple root of 2 is going to change that shape so we don't get those two turns. All right, now watch. Do you all see that the root has to be 2 because 2 minus 2 is 0? And because this factor is being cubed, that root is a triple root. So let's put a yellow dot at x equals 2. Right there. Now, if I expanded this, my leading term would be 1x to the third power. So that is an odd power with a positive leading coefficient. So odd degree with leading coefficient positive implies, okay, odd diagonal. That means either 3 to 1 or 2 to 4. But leading coefficient positive, this is a leading coefficient of 1, means we have to go from quadrant 3 to quadrant 1. So, what does a triple root look like? Okay, well, I'm going to start down here in quadrant 3, maybe even over a little bit. This won't be perfect. And I'm going to work up to my triple root. Now, remember what it said. It flattens out and then goes through and then takes off again. So here's your general shape, very roughly. Come on up, watch my arrow, flatten out, and then take off again. 3 to 1, here it is. And that's what a triple root looks like. Oh, my. That is a very good graph right there, too. That looks excellent. Okay, so that is the shape of a triple root. So you need to know that a single root, the graph goes through the x-axis. A double root, the graph is tangent to the x-axis. It kisses the x-axis. And a triple root, the graph comes up, flattens out, and goes through the x-axis, just like that. All right, let's do another one. Uh-oh, what happened there? That's the one we just did, isn't it? I must have hit the back button accidentally. All right, here it is right here. So we have y equals the quantity x minus 2 to the third power. So the only difference here is I have a negative out front. So my root is still 2, and that 2 is still a triple root because the factor x minus 2 is being cubed. All right, so let's go to positive 2, and let's put a yellow dot to represent a triple root right there. Okay, now if I expand this, isn't my leading term going to be negative 1x to the third power? So I have an odd degree polynomial whose leading coefficient is negative. Odd degree with leading coefficient negative implies, well, odd degree means we're working diagonal, but a negative leading coefficient means instead of going from quadrant 3 to quadrant 1, we're going to go from quadrant 2 down here to quadrant 4. And because this is a triple root, it's that same general shape. We're just coming on down, we're flattening out, and then going through and finishing down there. So this is the last graph reflected in the x-axis. Take a look. Well, visualize the last graph before we do this. You see the graph we just did? Okay, take a peek at your notes. Now take that graph and reflect it in the x-axis. And we're working from 2 to 4. And here it is. Booyah! Beautiful. I love this stuff. All right. I think we have one more. And this polynomial will be y equals x minus 1 to the third power times the quantity x minus 3. Okay, I see a root of 1, and that's a triple root. So you know I'm going to go yellow dot at x equals 1. And then I see a root of 3, and that's a single root. So I'm going to put a red dot at 3. Okay, and now I'm ready. If I expanded this, I'd have x to the third times x. I have an x to the fourth, a 1x to the fourth. All right, so that's even degree with a leading coefficient that is positive. Even degree with leading coefficient positive implies what to what? And I always say it and then I forget to do it. All right, but here it is right here. Even degree, we work horizontally. Leading coefficient positive, quadrant 2 to quadrant 1. So I know right now, I have to start in quadrant 2. I've got to come down to my triple root, where I will flatten out, and then go through the x-axis, and then turn up and go through that single root, and finish in the quadrant 1. Oh, I forgot to do it again. I got so excited. So we're working 2 to 1, and here it is. Oh, look at that. Beautiful. All right. You guys, be experts at this. I have some problems for you. Get a lot of graph paper, and remember, all we are worried about is your general shape and your roots, and make sure you know the difference between a single root, a double root, and a triple root. And I'm going to have you discover in your homework, if I gave you the graph, could you come up with the function? I think you can. Let's see. So, do 2.3, do just the written exercises, and that's 1 through 15 odd, 21 through 24, and 29 through 32. Remember, the answers to the odd problems are in the back of your book. There's some evens here, so I will post the even answers in our Google Classroom. I hope you guys had as much fun as I just had. Have a great day, and we will see you soon. I know.